I'm a cosplayer, like the rest of us are, I think. And they asked me to come here and talk about stuff, so that's what I'm doing.
I'm Helston. I'm also known as Booba Fett, and I cosplay, and I run a geek website called The Entertainment Siren. I'm just a geek, and I like dressing up, showing love for my fandom.
Hi everybody, I'm Michelle. I go by Angie Barker online. No connection to my real name at all. I've always loved dressing up and getting into character, and I never really saw myself as an actress, so I found cosplay as kind of this interesting outlet of like public theater where I can kind of just become characters that I would never have an opportunity to become, and have people, you know, appreciate that and get excited with me about, you know, the character that I and the people that I'm hanging out with are.
You know, the original idea, and if I got this wrong to whoever was there when we suggested this, maybe some of the people here don't know exactly what cosplay is. I think there's a lot of I think there's a lot of misconceptions on what it is people are doing, and it's not just the girls. I mean, the guys as well, and we just wanted to see if people were interested in the program. It turned out they were, and now you're here. So I guess, just like anything, just let some people know what it is that you do or why you do it, you know, your interest in doing it. Please just be comfortable, you know.
I have a really long in-depth backstory of why I talk to
you. I think we would love to hear that.
Okay. So, like, somewhere, this is, everyone's like, oh, cosplay changed my life. But, like, it really did have a huge impact on my life. And I think that, like, somewhere in an alternate universe, it's like a community-style darkest timeline where I never started cosplay. And, like, now I'm missing an arm and all my friends are dead. So, but I was 14 and I was a freshman in high school when I met a girl in biology class who introduced me to cosplay. Because I was always, like, I was an artist in school. I started out as an art major in college, which is fashion design. And I was always drawing. I had I didn't even know what sketch before at this point. I had a folder full of loose sheets of computer printer paper that I was drawing on. And I would always just sit there and talk and draw. And she was like, hey, I see that you like anime and you like drawing. You know, have you ever cosplayed? And I was like, and she showed me pictures and I was like, this exists. This is like all of my dreams of kittens and rainbows like showering on me in happiness. And there weren't really, this was in 2001, somewhere in there. I forget how old I am. And there weren't, the cons weren't, like there wasn't one every weekend like there is now. And I grew up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and didn't really have any cons in the town at the time. She told me about Otakon, which she had just gotten back from that summer, and I was like, this is like Mecca, like I have to go and make this pilgrimage, but of course I was 14 and I had no money. And so that year they started up the first ever anime convention in Pittsburgh, and it's called Chikosakon, that's still going on. And it's actually kind of a big deal now, which is surprising. So I went to the first ever anime con in Pittsburgh, and it was like in a hotel, there were like 20 people there, you know, tiny little thing, no real programming, but I made my costume, my first costume. And I had not a clue how to use a sewing machine. I made it up as I went along. Half of it was held together with talk glue. I don't know how familiar any of you are with anime, but it seemed like a really obscure anime, because even at 14 I was like, sure I didn't know it. Called Noir. And the character from Noir, and she's an assassin, and she has like, it's like a black body suit, and a big old cape situation, and all of these like straps around her arms. For all of those scraps, I used dog collars from the dollar store. And I remember, this is like, everyone here at the table is going to laugh at this so hard. The material for the cape cost me $36, and I thought that was so much money. I was like, holy shit, I just spent $36 on fabric. Like, no way, that's my like allowance for a month and a half. Yeah. So anyway, I made this costume and I wore it and I couldn't afford a wig, so I just kind of tied my hair up in like sort of the same way that the character had her hair. And I wore it to the con and I entered the Hall Cosplay Contest and I won first place.
Oh.
And I was out of like 20 people at this con, you guys have to understand, there was no one at this convention. There were maybe five other people in costume, but I beat all of them and I won first place. And then I was hooked from that point. So I started going to Cosplay Con every year, and then when I was 18, I finally went to like my first out-of-state con, Otakon. And then I just started keep going to more and more whenever I had the money, and I was able to convince my mom that I wasn't going to die or get raped or murdered or, I don't know, ambushed by kobolds or werewolves or something, I don't know. It led me to all of the friends, pretty much all of the friends that I have today I met through cosplay. I wouldn't know any of these girls. I wouldn't have met my husband. I met him through cosplay. We met through mutual cosplaying friends, and he proposed to me at Comic-Con in 2011 on the Marvel Comics stage. I was dressed as a USO girl, and he was Captain America in costumes that I made, and then we got to hang out with Stanley afterwards, and it was super cool. And that was also the year that like I met Josh Whedon, and I met Nathan Fillion and Will Patrick Castle, and like all of these things that I never would have got to do had it been for cosplay. And cosplay is also what made me realize that I wanted to be a costume designer, so that's what I came to Los Angeles to pursue. I'm not from here originally, I moved here about 3 months ago to pursue a career in costume design for film and television. And that's what I'm doing now, sort of just a freelance type situation, and it's working out pretty well so far. So my life would be completely different if I hadn't discovered cosplay at this point. Made all of these friends and done all of these awesome things. So, you know, I wouldn't even be here in LA because there's another like super weird friend situation. I was gonna live in an apartment in Sherman Oaks, and then that landlord came back to a giant douche and like dropped out on us at the last minute and was like, sorry, we're not renting to you. And it was 2 weeks before I was supposed to move here, and I had a moving truck booked and I couldn't change it and all of this crap. And I was like, I can find an apartment right away. So my husband and I flew out here for a weekend. And a friend of ours who we met at Comic-Con, who was the person who allowed us, she like emceed the engagement and sort of arranged for the whole thing to happen on the Marvel stage. She knew a guy who is now my landlord, who happened to have a apartment for rent. So like, I wouldn't even have a house if it wasn't for cosplay. I would be homeless. So, there we go. So that's the story of how cosplay made my life.
I think all of it. Oh, I think Claire is a beautiful example of, pretty much to me, like the type of person who cosplays and like the average person you will hopefully encounter. Cosplay has no one definition, but for the majority of people you're going to run into, cosplay, you know, is costume play, specifically people who are generally fans of a certain show, comic, movie, who are so passionate, generally for a specific character, that they express their appreciation and fandom by making or getting made a costume to then go portray that character. And some of us take it very seriously, and some of us, you know, just do it for fun, or there's a mix in between. At the end of the day, it is a hobby. But, you know, for me and Claire here, you know, we're looking at a character, let's say Jean Grey, and I just absolutely am in love of being a creative person. I am drawn to the costume, I am drawn to the character's personality, I love those qualities, I want to, in the real world, represent that character and that particular costume. Then I go and make it, or make my fiancé make it for me, or maybe a commission to be made. And for some of us, replicating as minutely perfectly as possible what the artist did is key to representing that character. So, in particular right now, I really hate whatever artist is on BTCT Supergirl and BTCT Superman who decided that drawing like 20 to 30 seam lines on the costume was a good idea, because they're kind of a dick. because I'm anal enough that I need to do all those lines at seam, and that's just a pain in the butt. But it's been worth it because I don't even have the costume that finished until like a year later. I was so excited with how how perfect I thought it replicated in real life what the artist had done. Like, I already used pictures in it. I'm actually already kind of known, I think, in that one.
Yeah.
Like, upper body shot.
From, like, here up.
Not
oh,
even
finished.
But, I mean, I will take the comic book with me to the fabric stores and, you know, fashion district. And once I've collected enough comics that where the ink colors represent the best version of her colors, I'm comparing it to swatches because I want to bring that comic page to life. And it's been interesting because obviously for many, if not most of you, drawing, you know, you're not probably thinking of someone in real life wearing this and maybe how it works in real life. And it's been really interesting as a cosplayer. And I also frequently have the same literal beginning origin story first chapter that Claire does, where I was 14 in high school, but like replaced art with band. but, you know, back when I started, you know, you've got, you know, kids and adults making these costumes and completely disconnected from the actual professional industry that is inspiring all of these people to go out and portray these characters at conventions and photo shoots and everything. To the point now where you've got some of the gaming industry, you know, costume game designers are actually sharing like really minute detailed photos with the cosplay community because they see people like re-advertising. Like, oh my god, that's
here?
Yeah,
so
like they
we want you to cosplay this. Here's some photos.
And they would like give you a full 360. It's so hard to get 360 sometimes with like characters, right? Mm-hmm. You're going do 100 different comics to get the right angle of every shot of the costume, or if you're a game, you're like pausing it halfway through and playing it 50 times over to try and get everything. So it's really interesting in the more recent years to see the industry actually connect with this hobby and actually help them because, you know, I'm hoping that they enjoy seeing their creations brought to life and kind of want to help them do a really good job of it.
And I think you touched on something really important, which is I think that every person in this room, correct me if I'm wrong, but you've been like reading a comic or watching a movie or watching a show and you're like, I want to be that person. Like, when I grow up, I want to be the Green Ranger. And for me, it was the Pink Ranger first. You know, I want to be the Pink Ranger, but I'm in a costume. But you think, I want to be that person. And cosplay allows you to do that. You can step into their shoes for a day. And one of the best feelings ever, I think, is when little kids come up to you and they think you are that person.
Yeah.
And they want to hug you and they want to take pictures with you. And, like, it's just a super cool feeling. It lets you, you know, you never have to really lose that magic of, like, playing to someone in your
kid. Yeah. And I had fun because you know, often we all frequent a lot of conventions and actually currently work for Wiz World, so I go to a lot of conventions now. And I work in Artist Alley and it's like the best thing ever. I've enjoyed over the years actually seeing some fellow cosplayers get relationships with different artists. And I mean, my friend Christy dates Scott Campbell. And she's been a muse for him, you know, and he, you know, uses a lot of her facial features in a lot of his art these days because of her, you know, her through her Slave Leia cosplay. I've seen other cosplayers actually go and take the time to make an original costume that an artist has come up with because the artist would love to see their character actually brought to life, and they obviously see us, and we have a passion, you know, because maybe we've read comics in first, and maybe we've only seen movies, but there's something about these characters that have been, you know, written and drawn that draws all of us together and has a passion, and, you know, you guys draw it, and then we want to see it. Watch the
scene. I got a little question, because I know the cosplay, it seems like you guys are really young. But I remember because I remember going to the earliest San Diego conventions and remember the guys who used to run around as Logan's Run characters. And they did, you know, so cosplay, I mean, that's been going on in some way or another. It's been going on long. Although it was Logan's Run characters and Rocky Horror Picture Show people. And then Star Wars came out, and then, you know, the research of Star Trek and blah, blah, blah. But it seems like you guys are really, you're fans, so you fixated on whatever the thing is of your generation, right? So you guys are like,
I don't know.
You know, well, the USO girl sounded really interesting.
Yeah, the version that I did was actually from the movie, and it was before the movie came out, so I was like Victoria said, like looking for screenshots. Like, I had a Captain America doll. There weren't a lot of good screenshots out there. I didn't know what the fabrics were, so I was just like looking at these little tiny pictures and like zooming in, and
that was a little
giant pain, but yeah. So I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, I'm just saying, is there like a sense of continuity from this, or just everybody jumps in with whatever they're interested in?
Well,
and
I would say the latter, but yeah. I mean, since it is born, I think of inspiration a lot of times. If there's something current, you're automatically going to jump onto it. And obviously, Avengers has been huge the last like 3 to 5 years because it's all in our faces. And the characters are great, and the costumes are great, and when we see the people's costumes in this movie, we're immediately like just cracked, and we like go for it. Meanwhile, we could also be doing a costume from something that originated 30 years ago.
Well, the one you're doing right now, that's like a 90s X-Men, isn't it? So you're going vintage, a look, or what, I don't know, classic, or kind of a DeLorean type of thing.
It is, and you know, because I love the Jim Lee design, even though you know, even Claire, a lot of people do Jean Grey and Phoenix. Like, I just love this yellow and blue, which to me really runs with 80s in its style. Big red hair, with thigh armor that no woman wants their thighs to be big. but it's great and it's iconic. And even though she's been, you know, redrawing different characters and different costumes over the years, and there's obviously her movie variations, like, hands down, this is the version I prefer, because that's just the Jean Grey I'm attracted to in character.
Yeah, I think at every con you'll go to, sure, you'll see, like, the flavor of the week, whatever that happens to be, whether it's whatever movie just came out, or whatever TV show, like Game of Thrones, or whatever is popular at the time. But you'll also see, like, 500 Slave Leia's, and how long has it been since that movie came out? I mean, that was before most of us were born. So,
well, that actually wanted to get into the next thing I wanted to talk about since you brought it up. Slave Leia is like almost a cliche that is now being taken and turned into. I've noticed a lot of mashups. You're being very classic. So is there like the classic people versus the mashup people?
No,
or
in a way that's
like
kind of the fun thing.
It delves a bit into the whole. There is no one definition for cosplay, for me there is, but for like the same people, and like I can be like crazy like one-sided, but then like appreciate the real world view, which is, you know, for some people it is just about having fun, and at the end of the day it's like about like all of us doing it, like it's just really fun, and for me it's fun to be crazy, like, you know, accurate and like do not deviate from what I see. For other people, and I'm still in that boat too, is to be like, dude, I love being Slave Leia. What if I was Slave Leia Boba Fett theme? That would be fun. And then people will do it. Or, you know, I love Slave Leia, but like, I don't like those colors. What if I made it silver and black? And so, you know, it's them, clearly, you're hoping, and 90% of the time it's true, they're a Star Wars fan, and they love that character, but they obviously are creative, and they don't want to be cycled into that little pigeonhole of that. They want to put themselves into the costume too, which is why I think we see an explosion of variation.
Yeah, there's
white
kind of going on right female now.
Female versions of male characters, male versions of female characters.
Yeah.
They like that
character.
They do their own spin on it. Obviously, I was a Avenger bunny because another reason why the USO girl in Captain America is so popular is actually a huge amount of girls love the pinup style era.
Yeah.
You know, the 50s where women were sexy without being slutty, they were incredibly strong and beautiful, and 50s obviously was 52. And so the USO like community of girls,
there's a Facebook group
is huge. I helped originate that group with Kathy, and
it's a little bit crazy,
gigantic. Like I made it more, but like it's just gone beyond that. And then I was in a group with some girls where we love the Playboy Bunny classic style, and we really love the Avengers, but so we made our mass-up versions of like all the Avengers characters plus Loki in the, you know, classic style of the bunny suits, which for the first, like, I think real deviant costume I'd ever done, where it was like not, you know, conforming to what I'm not a male, and I'm not Tom Hiddleston, and so. But I did what I could to reflect the costume design in that, matching the outfits that I could do, metal leather and like that and matching all the stuff I saw.
There's a big movement. Going on right now for like these variant costumes. So people will do like burlesque version of Call. Like I did a burlesque version of Poison Ivy that was inspired by Nicole Kidman's outfits in Moulin Rouge. So I did that as like Poison Ivy. Or people will do like the Playboy Bunny version. Or they'll do like
steampunk
version. Sure. Yeah. I have a couple friends who are really awesome DC Universe steampunk and it's super cool. And I think that's part of the fun of it is like, well, everyone's done, you know, the classic Poison Ivy and we've covered leotards. But has anyone done like this version? Has anyone done a male version? And gender bending, as Christine said, is a super fun thing.
Favorite thing. Yeah. I just mentioned Cobb from Firefly and it was the two funnest things I ever did in costume. And how she said she likes her costumes being accurate, I'm the same way, but I try to do gender bending, but making it still accurate to the character. So Jane, I still had Lamotte Pistol, I still had Vera, I did everything to the costume that was almost exactly accurate, even the stupid spats that they brought us out. It's still Jane's costume.
The
female version. Like, if I was Jane, and I was a girl, how would I dress? My friends at first in the group were like, well, do we want a sexy group, or do we want to do, like, an actor? I'm like, we're doing an actor. I'm not a big, like, I want to wear a sexy costume. I do eventually, but more of the characters I've picked tend to be rough and...
characters.
Just like, yeah. So for Jane, I was like, Jane would still be, like, I'm going to cut the sleeves off this shirt, and I'm going to wear it like this. And so I was like, how Jane would. And I had the most fun being that character and doing it. It's so much fun. Some people didn't like it. Some people gave me some crap.
Some people are assholes.
Yeah. But when I started schooling them on Firefly, they couldn't shut their mouth.
You said it right there. I've been doing the shows and many years when it was just people in costumes, the fantasy shows. We all did World Fantasy Con way back before any of you were born. And there was always people in costumes. But what I've seen, especially like at Bakersfield, we probably have 500 people dressed up that will show, is you're all four very attractive girls. But having said that, a lot of the people that dress up aren't. It doesn't matter. That's what I'm saying. When they walk in that door, they're accepted by everybody. Out in the real world, they're not. And the cosplay, and I've noticed more and more, gets them more accepted in the world they want to be accepted into and makes more friends, just like you were saying.
Right.
And when it first started, being a strictly comic book guy, I was like, you know, 20 years ago, really? But now I see it as one of the better parts of our convention.
Yeah, well, this becomes like it becomes a common misconception because people think, oh, I can't cosplay that character because I don't look like them.
Oh,
okay?
No.
Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what race you are, doesn't matter what gender you are, doesn't matter what body type you are. Like, do it and everyone will say, awesome, you're super cool. You will make 1,000 friends with that.
You guys all know Ivy, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ivy did it, yeah.
Ivy represents our show, so I love Ivy to death. Ivy is a big girl.
Mm-hmm.
Big and beautiful.
She rocks the
and
hell out of it.
And she rocks the hell out of it. Nobody's ever come up to her. Boy, I've never seen Poison Ivy. Like for Dr. Doom, she just speaking of the gender, but it's amazing Dr. Doom for San Diego Con. Mm-hmm. But nobody goes, and your thighs are too big for that. They go, wow, that's awesome.
Well, I guess that's what I was going to say was how I started cosplaying was being intensely bullied as a kid. And I hid myself in my comic books and my video games. Just literally would hide and like to see that. And when I started doing costuming, not only did I feel like it felt good to be that character, but when I went to my first con in costume, I was terrified. And it was neat seeing people. I was lost in Final Fantasy VI as a video game character. Really kind of obscure unless you played Final Fantasy. And having random people come up to me and be like, oh my god, are you lost in Final Fantasy VI? And be so excited was really neat. And it made me feel really good, and it made me want to do it more often. Especially see people like me light up to see a character that they adore inside you. And it is all about, like, I've never had a bad experience cosplaying yet.
I mean, there are bad eggs.
Yeah,
There are people out there who will say, there's this whole thing right now with people who are, like, they're like, you're a fake geek.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what is this bullshit?
I've actually heard that stuff. Yeah. And promoter, we've actually got some feedback, and it's like, no, just shut up.
I think that the whole, like, at its core, the cosplay community is about being a community. It's about being accepted for the things that everyone else in the world doesn't really understand. And when people start to say, well, no, you have to meet certain criteria, you have to know X, Y, Z about the character, you have to know their whole backstory before you can dress with them, it's like, no, calm down. Like, if someone wants to do something and they're having a good time and they're here just to enjoy, you know, what they're doing, who are you to judge them? Like, you know, everybody came here under a sense of wanting to be somewhere where they're comfortable and they're happy and they can belong. Because I think all of us have had experiences where, as a kid, like, people didn't understand us. We were bullied. I just posted a picture on my Facebook.
I wasn't. You were lame.
It doesn't matter if you were, but a lot of us were.
We were all in the
school. You were in bed.
Yeah, that's no. Terrible.
No, I probably lose to begin with.
Yeah.
You
had
the
band geek community.
But you know what told me?
You had the other band geek
with you.
I was ditching English to play D&D in the band closet, which I realized right. Both of you had.
In the band closet?
Because my four best friends were guys, so. Let's go play D&D. Let's go skip AP English to go play D&D.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have band practice.
Yeah.
I was already in the
like ignorant.
This is my bubble. My dad.